Welcome everybody. You're watching Mr. FUBU Data Science. Today, we're gonna focus specifically on the binomial distribution. As always, I'd like to say thank you to the recent subscribers and viewers. I greatly appreciate it. Get a hold of me on Instagram and Twitter. Also, I set up Buy Me a Coffee because it takes a long time to make these videos. So please help support this channel. I'd appreciate it, thank you. Now, you only have a couple imports today. So you could follow along with me and pause the video, or you can go on my GitHub, which will be in the link in the description, to download today's code. The binomial distribution can be thought of as the sum of the Bernoulli trials, which end up giving you the binomial distribution. Okay, so if you're doing like a heads and tails, success, fail situation, and you have a large number of trials, that's where you end up with this distribution. The PDF can be explained by this formula right here. We'll simplify explaining this below. You have your mean and your standard deviation here if you look at the cursor. The simplified version of thinking about this can stem from four things. Each of your outcomes is independent for each trial. You have a fixed number of trials and the probability of success for each trial is the same. And the only two outcomes you have is true, false, success, fail. Okay? The things you should know from this, the 1 minus x deals with your fails. The p of x is your probability of the number of successes for each trial n. Your x is your success. Your x is the number of successes in each trial of n. P is your probability of success. And n is just the number of trials. Now, let's see what happens when we vary the number of trials, okay? Keeping everything else constant. That's what ceteris paribus means. Now, we're going to have the probability of 0.5, and we're going to vary the number of samples we're going to have for each trial, and let's see what happens. If you pay attention, as we increase our samples from 5 to 100, you notice that you approach a normal distribution. Your mean, which is your peak for each one of these, shifts because now you have more samples to basically do a comparison against for your given probability. So you have more of a chance of landing on something over here if you have more times to achieve it, basically. Then we have our CDF, and this is the function for that. And if you notice right here, this is the floor function for K inside of here, okay? So let's understand what's going on. You're basically finding the probability of obtaining the probability you observe less than or equal to some X number of successes in N trials with some given probability. So just remember, it's less than or equal to the number of successes. That's all you have to get from the takeaway of that. We'll see what this looks like in a plot soon so you get more of a definitive idea. Now, some tips that you can look at when you're evaluating this plot. You're going to notice that it has an S curve. The steeper it is, the smaller the width of the curve. For instance, if it's almost a vertical curve, you'll have a high amount of kurtosis, which means that if you are plotting this and looking at it as a density plot, you're going to have some really fat tails. Okay. You also get something that looks more normal as that curve starts approaching 45 degrees, okay? And if you were plotting two curves and they looked identical, but they were shifted, it would just be in a multiplicative effect. You just have some variable is shifting it. Like if you had two parallel lines that were the same and you just had some variable that was a multiplier, okay? The other thing that I need to mention is that if you have a lot of trials and it's fairly symmetric for your success failure rate, then you can approximate the distribution itself. But you need a lot of trials for that. So we're going to look briefly at two CDF plots real quick, and you're going to see what's going on. So I decided to first start with looking at a probability of 15, followed by a probability of 40, given that we have the same amount of trials. And let's scroll down, and we'll notice that the first one with probability of 15 approaches 1 fairly quickly. At about 9, you're already at 100. So you would interpret this like this. You would say that for any value of k for our success would be summed up as a cumulative sum of anything that happened prior to it. So for instance, if this was to say Let's say that this was 90%. We would say that we have a 95% probability of success given any value that is at least 6 because it's summing everything that's previous. Then we'll look at the same thing, but with a probability of 40. And you'll notice that it's going up to about 17 would encompass 100% of our data. And then everything else is just really irrelevant. Now let's notice the relationship between the PDF and the CDF if we were looking at exactly 8. So we would see that the PDF, we would need to sum everything until we reached 8 in order to get this one particular line for the CDF representing the same thing. So roughly it's like 70 something, right? So if you summed all of these together on this PDF, you get this one line right here, which is this representation. That's the only distinction if you're trying to use this for interpreting. These are the available functions that you have within R. And the one thing that I want to mention that's of great importance here is this lower tail. If it equals true, you're going to the left. If it's false, you're going to the right. Okay? Now, the D for the density is returning your PDF. The P is returning basically your CDF that we just looked at above. And you have to notice that you're interested less than or equal to or greater than or equal to for your trials of Q, all right? That's something you need to pay attention to. That's what that should be changed to, actually. You have your Q, which is dealing with your quantiles, and that's letting you to predict a number of successes. So you throw in some quantile, like the lower 10%, so you do 0.10, or you say like the upper 60%, 0.6, something like this, right? Or the upper 10%. 0.9. You chuck all that in with your probability of success and whatever your trials are, and it spits out a number, which is a predicted number of how many successes you'll have with that data. It's the opposite of using the P binome, okay? And instead, you're getting a less than or equal to the size that you're chucking in. That's something you need to pay attention to, okay? I didn't put anything for this because you're just creating a random distribution, and we're going to see this a lot when we're plotting this out. So a few things you should pay attention to, and I'm going to mention this specifically in the plot. You could pause this and read it, but I'm going to mention it when we look below. So this varies some probabilities and see what happens with these data. We're going to look at a probability of 20%, 50%, 70%, given that we're going to have 40 trials, and we're just going to use this random one and do it 1,000 times. Let's see what happens. So I used a random seed, and this is what we got with this specific random seed. When you just keep running this, these are going to change because you're using R binome. So just be aware of that. So yours is going to look different than mine. The first thing that I want to mention is this. As a probability goes from left to right, from 0.05, the curve will skew to one side or the other for the peak. Okay? The next thing I want to suggest is that for the same number of successes, but altering the probability, you'll notice that you have this shifting, okay? So we go from lower to higher probabilities, and you'll see that the mean for each of these causes it to shift, because basically, as you have more opportunities to achieve a higher probability, for instance, if I had more successes available to me, and I knew that for each success I had a high probability, that means that this probability is going to now increase. You understand what I'm saying? That's the gist you could take away from that. And let's figure out what some of these numbers are doing. So these are the same things that we did for this plot above. So you can get a numerical value so we can kind of go up and compare this. Okay, so you can see that we have about 8, 20, and 27 for the mean for each of these probabilities for our simulated version with the random binomial. So you got about 8, got like 19, 20, and then about, I don't know, 28 or so. So it looks like it's lining up somewhat. And this is gonna lop over to one side or the other, just depending on how you're running this without a seed. That's what I printed out here. Now notice that these are the simulated values because these were relevant to the randomness that we created above. But we can also get the exact values from these as well. Here's the actual values that we're going to look at real quick, but just notice something. What is really going on here? For instance, if we had 40 items that had a 20% chance of occurring, what was the probability of exactly getting 8? We ended up with 15.6%. So I ran this for each one of the exact values so we could get a comparison and see what is actually going on. You are going to have some discrepancy between the simulated and the actual values. Take note of that, all right? Chance of finding exactly 8, assuming that we're going to have a probability of 20 of our 40 people sampled for each trial, who really like coffee. And let's see what the probability of success would be if we had exactly 8 people out of 40 who liked coffee. So feel free to pause this if you want to write this down or figure out how to decipher this. But here we go. Out of 40 people, we wanted exactly 8 people. Exactly 8 people, we have a 16% chance that they like coffee, given that the trial had 40 people and we knew that there was a 20% chance that they would like coffee. Now let's look at less than or equal to 8 people, where in this case we're looking at the left tail and we have to say lower tail equals true here. Okay, that's what's going on with this. And if you notice here, we're using the PMF and the CDF, so we're able to plot this out, okay? So just pay attention to that, because we're looking at the less than or equal to, so remember, CDF, okay? So we have our less than or equal to, and it turns out at 8, we have 59%. Okay, fine. Which means that we'll have a 59.3% probability of obtaining less than or equal to 8, given for each trial we had 40, whatever it is, with a 20% chance of whatever it is occurring. Okay, here's the simulated value versus the exact value. If you keep running this value, you're going to get different values each time you run it. Just be aware of that, unless you run a seed. Then let's do an upper tail, which is your right side, meaning that we need to now do lower tail equals false. And let's use this problem. It's just a joke, of course. Assume we have a group of chickens we want to catch, but they're really fast. And say we have 40 chickens and we have a 20% chance of catching them with a whistle that attracts them. What's the probability of catching at least 8 chickens? Meaning we want 8 or more. Okay, fine. We got to remember something that's really important here, okay? You're going to need to do 1 minus your Q value, okay? If you're doing greater than. Otherwise, if you're doing strictly greater than, you could just use Q. Now, let's get into this. When you're doing the plot, you're going to have your Q equal to -1 and then 1 minus whatever the max value is, so you can establish this number. Because if you leave it at 0 to 40, what you're really going to get is a strictly greater than value, which is not what you want. Or what you can do is keep this, but lower this value to 7 instead. That's another option you can do. So you'll notice that if we're looking at this right tail and we want 8 greater than or equal to finding our little chickens, we got a 50% chance of obtaining this, given that we had a 20% chance of catching a chicken with a trial of 40. And here's the simulated values. And here's another way that you can do this same thing to do like a self-check. That's what I had to do because I was like, what the hell is going on here when I first did this, because it was kind of odd. I said, if I'm taking the left tail and I'm doing 1 minus that, I'm going to obtain everything else, okay? And so I had to do by 7 and not 8 for each of these to line up. And then this is still the same. Now we can get into our strictly greater than. And I did this where I could have instead kept this formatting of 0 to 40, but I could have also just changed this value instead of 8. I could have increased it. And that would have worked as well. So that's just a side note. So this assumes that we have 20% of adults that are allergic to bathing due to allergic reactions. Assuming they're given magic soap, there are 40 people given the medicated soap. What is the probability that the medication is effective in more than 8 people studied? Because, you know, sometimes people just don't like showering and they need magic soap. Of course, I'm joking. Or am I? Now, I did the same goofy thing. Just pay attention to that. And let's look at this. Let's scroll in here. And we'll notice that right here, you got to pay attention to this. Because if you're doing your plotting wrong, it'll be over here on your 8. So just pay attention because you want greater than 8. Okay? So we got a 41% chance, given that we provide some magic soap to these 40 people, that 9 or greater of these people will respond favorably to using it, considering there is a 20% chance that they wouldn't use the soap in the first place. Okay, then we got our same little digits here, but let's get into some considerations. The PDF is great if you have tag words such as exact, some, or some specific number. And then CDF has tag words like no more than, at most, fewer than, less than, etc. We have a quantile that we can use. And I'm not going to give an expression here because you're returning an actual number, a predicted number. So this assume I have 40 people who fall in the bottom 10% of decorum with a 75% chance of being weird. And each time we test 40 people, that means that we have 0 to 26 people of 40 who fit this category. And if you're not sure what this is, That's me just joking around again. Now, the decile is something that's interesting. You're evaluating, do the subsample variations change over different subsamples? What the hell does that mean? Let's take the thing from above. Let's assume that we were looking at those 40 people with a 75% chance of not having decorum, and we're going to throw them in the lower 10th quantile, or you could say first decile, I guess is how that would work out. And what's happening is it's splitting this into the 26 to 40 that we had, but it's not splitting them based on like 26 through like 40. You know, you see this range and it seems kind of odd here, right? But just look at this. You're basically deciding, hey, this is the numbers from 26 to 40 on the y-axis, and on the x-axis you have your proportion, and you're evaluating with this S looking thing, hey, how much is this changing relative to the other points for this trend? I'm not really familiar with this type of analysis. I stumbled on it. It's really good for academic stuff, investing, economics, and stuff like that. And I left a page that you can go to and look at this to evaluate. But that's just not something I'm familiar with, so I'm not going to do some interpretations on this. But as always, please like, share, and subscribe. And if you subscribe, turn on that notification bell. Don't forget to hit me up on those socials. And if you can, and you like the material, hit me up on Buy Me a Coffee. I greatly appreciate it. Have a good one. See you in the next video. Bye.